Namaskar, this is First Post and you're watching Vantage with me, Palki Sharma. The lead story tonight is unsettling. We thought we'd left this behind us, but here's what we have. A new mysterious outbreak in China. Hundreds of children are in hospital. People asking authorities if there's a cover-up. Beijing not spelling out what the disease is, and the WHO asking for information and lab reports. Sounds like a scary case of deja vu. We hope it doesn't snowball. We'll tell you what's going on in China. Meanwhile, Vladimir Putin has said, we must think about stopping the Ukraine war. Is this a note to self, a climb down, or a bluff? We'll discuss that. More drama in the Sam Altman story. What is Project Q Star? Is it dangerous AI? Is this why he was sacked? In America, a former presidential advisor and big shot in the State Department has been arrested for Islamophobia. Will they add it in their religious freedom reports? Why did the Mossad chief go to Qatar? Who is the winner of the Dutch election and what does his victory mean for Europe? Is Russia weaponizing the border with Finland and what is volcano tourism? All these stories and more coming up, the headlines first. In India, the Uttarakhand tunnel rescue operation is in its final stage. The 41 trapped workers are expected to be pulled out soon. They have been trapped in this under-construction tunnel since the 12th of November. Iran's foreign minister meets the Hezbollah chief in Lebanon. Since the start of the Gaza war, Hezbollah has traded heavy cross-border fire with Israel. The violence has killed more than 100 people in Lebanon, mostly from the Hezbollah. In Pakistan, Imran Khan's party ordered to hold leadership polls within 20 days. The Election Commission says it must do so to retain its election symbol, a cricket bat. Pakistan is set to hold general elections next year. Imran Khan is currently in jail, facing a slew of legal cases. Niger's military ruler visits Mali. This is his first foreign trip since seizing power in July. Their neighbors, Mali and Burkina Faso, are also ruled by the military. Both countries have pledged their support to Niger's coup leaders. And Paris says, get set, stop. The transport system in Paris will not be ready for the 2024 Olympic Games. That's the warning from the mayor of the French capital. The 2024 Olympic Games in Paris will be held in July and August. It's happening again. China's hospitals are filling up with patients. Almost all of them are children. Their symptoms are strikingly similar to the Wuhan virus, high fever and lung infection. There are many clusters of patients. Doctors say they have pneumonia, but they don't know what's causing the infection. They've failed to figure out the root cause. Is this a new variant of the Wuhan virus? Is it a bacterium or a new disease altogether? As always, China is not being transparent. And I know what you're thinking. This is a repeat of 2019. It sounds like one when mysterious disease was ripping through China. First, Beijing played down the outbreak. Then they concealed the truth. And the result was a global pandemic, the worst of our times. 4 years later, we have a new outbreak in China, one that Beijing cannot explain. So what really is happening? There is limited information as of now. We don't know exactly when the outbreak began or how many patients are in hospital. But we can tell you that the hotspot is northern China. The surge seems recent, also unexpected. Some reports say hospitals are overwhelmed and schools on the verge of a shutdown, obviously because this is affecting children. So parents in China are worried. In one instance, they were heard asking authorities if they're covering up another outbreak. So not just the rest of the world, even the people of China do not trust their government. And clearly they were not ready for this. Also, there is something strange about this outbreak, the fact that it's hitting only children. Not many adults are showing these symptoms. The number of infected children, though, is quite high. Meanwhile, a new report is doing the rounds. It comes from a platform called ProMed. Now, ProMed is basically a surveillance system built by the International Society for Infectious Diseases. And what does ProMed do? It monitors disease outbreaks the world over. This is where a lot of doctors first learned about the Wuhan virus. ProMed had carried reports of the first cases in 2019. And now it is focusing on the new outbreak in China. And here is what it says. It has called the disease an undiagnosed pneumonia. That's what experts are also calling it, an undiagnosed pneumonia. The report also features some quotes from locals. One of them is from Beijing, from inside a children's hospital. This is what a local resident in Beijing said, and I'm quoting, "Many, many are hospitalized. They don't cough and have no symptoms. They just have a high temperature or fever, and many develop pulmonary nodules." Now, you're not allowed to report to school. If you have any symptoms such as fever, cold, cough, and then you're hospitalized, you can ask for leave. Then there are more ground reports. The second one is from the Liaoning province. Again, this is from a children's hospital. It's called the Dalian Children's Hospital. The situation here is quite bad. Locals say the hospital lobby is full of sick children. They're receiving intravenous or IV drips. Children are receiving IV drips in the hospital lobby. I have a quote from a hospital staffer. This is what he says, "Patients have to wait in line for 2 hours, and we are all in the emergency department, and there are no general outpatient clinics." So the outbreak is large and serious. Some videos are spreading on Chinese social media. We've not been able to verify these, but they are quite shocking. It appears children are doing their classes from hospitals. Take a look at this. These are scary pictures. It's the worst sight for any parent, their child on a drip doing schoolwork. So what are Chinese authorities doing? Last week, they held a press conference. There were officials from China's National Health Commission. And did they have any answers? I'm afraid not. They sounded clueless. They said, this surge in cases is linked to pandemic restrictions. What does that mean? Let me explain. During the pandemic, China followed something called a zero COVID policy. It was a totalitarian approach. There were mass lockdowns. Everyone had to undergo a test, and patients were treated like criminals. They were picked up from their homes, sometimes by force, and they were locked up in quarantine centers. It did not work. Instead of achieving zero COVID, China was killing its economy. So in the month of January this year, they abandoned the policy. This was more than 10 months back. And now Chinese experts say it led to what they're calling an immunity gap, meaning people who don't have a strong immune system are falling sick.
Children's immune systems are not well developed. Specific and non-specific immunity functions are not very matured, including our children's relatively weak cough reflex, insufficient function of respiratory motile cilia, low levels of immunoglobulin of our children, which may all easily cause infection.
But what is their sickness? Which disease is this that is exclusively targeting children? Chinese officials have given a range of possibilities. It could be the Wuhan virus, influenza, respiratory syncytial virus or RSV, or a disease called mycoplasma pneumoniae. This is a common bacterial infection. It affects younger children. And China says all these diseases are in circulation right now, so it could be any of these. But they cannot say for sure what's driving the current outbreak. Now, the World Health Organization wants answers. They've asked China to share more data, including patient lab tests. Not sure if that will be enough, especially given the WHO's track record and how they handled China with kid gloves 3 years back. 3 years have passed. We still don't know what happened in Wuhan. And now there's a new outbreak in China. The WHO is offering us more of the same, a statement of concern and a recommendation to wear masks again. It's a textbook example of the famous saying, the more things change, the more they remain the same. We can only hope that this is not one more pandemic in the making. Does Vladimir Putin want to end the war? I know what you're thinking. Which one? In Gaza, Putin wants an immediate ceasefire. In Ukraine, he is the aggressor. But could he be softening his position? And here's why I ask. Yesterday, the G20 leaders held a virtual meeting. It was like a follow-up to the summit in New Delhi. And since it was virtual, Putin attended it. Listen to what he said.
Yes, of course. Military actions are always a tragedy for specific people, specific families, and the whole country. And of course, we must think about how to stop this tragedy. By the way, Russia has never refused peace negotiations with Ukraine. I understand that this is war. Human losses cannot but shock.
Two things to note here. Number one, Putin said we must think about stopping the war. He says Russia has never refused talks. And number two, Putin did not say special military operation. He called it a war. Now put together, what does it mean? Frankly, with Vladimir Putin, you can never be sure. Maybe he's softening his position or maybe he's pulling a bluff. There is only one way to know. To look at the political and military situation around the war, let's start with the battlefield. Most of the action is around the Dnipro River. Its eastern bank is held by Russia. And since June this year, Kiev has been trying to take it back. For 5 months, they had no success. Their counteroffensive was stalled. Then last week, things changed. Kiev says it pushed Russian soldiers back by 8 kilometers. Some of their armored vehicles also crossed the river. So now Ukraine has a foothold in the eastern bank. It's probably the first success of the counteroffensive. Is that why Putin is talking about peace? It seems unlikely, because one battle does not determine anything. After all, Russia still holds 20% of Ukraine's total land, so it could be one factor, but it's certainly not the only factor. Then we come to the politics of it. American support for Ukraine is shaky right now. The US Congress is holding up aid packages. So the European Union is stepping up, or at least trying to step up. They have drafted long-term security commitments for Ukraine. What does that mean? More funding, more training, and more help for Ukraine's defense industry. You see, long-term commitments offer stability, something that America's aid packages have lacked. The question is, will the EU members agree? Will they be able to pull it off? Their diplomats will discuss the proposal over the weekend. The heads of state will hold talks next month. I guess the point is, Ukraine is not collapsing. The West will keep this war running. But can Vladimir Putin afford that? His domestic situation is challenging. If you ask the Kremlin, Russia's economy is booming. They will say, what sanctions? But in reality, things are more serious. A leading Russian economist has confirmed this. He says most Russians are now living on low wages. It's not surprising, though. Russia's central bank has hiked interest rates to 15%, meaning more debt for people. Their currency, the ruble, is also sliding. In June last year, one US dollar was equal to 57 rubles. And now it's almost 89 rubles. Last month, it was more than 100. So the currency is sliding and it is volatile. And this is shaping Russian public opinion. Let me show you what a recent survey found. 48% Russians wanted Moscow to end the war, 48%, to pursue peace talks. And 39% wanted to continue the invasion. Now, this survey was done by the Russian Field Company. They've been doing such polls since the invasion began, but the latest one is special. It's the first time more Russians wanted peace than war. Could that be playing on President Putin's mind? He has an election next year. The victory seems certain. There could be more drama, maybe protests or opposition campaigns. And ideally, Putin would like to avoid that. And finally, there's the question of foreign support. Putin's biggest ally is China, but right now, China's own economy is in dire straits. It's so bad that Xi Jinping is patching up with Joe Biden. He visited the US last week. He asked for a reset with Washington. And that's not good news for Putin. He prefers China and the US to be at conflict. So let me recount the factors at play here. Ukraine is making small military gains. Europe could plug America's funding gap. Russia's economy is showing signs of strain, and the people want peace. If you're Vladimir Putin, that's a signal to wind up the war. But like I said, you can never be sure. If only these leaders would take their own advice, Putin should take his advice on Gaza and use it in Ukraine. And Biden should take his advice on Ukraine and use it in Gaza. As far as wishes go, it seems like an impossible one. Now let's talk about OpenAI. We haven't heard the end of it yet. Yes, Sam Altman is back as the undisputed leader. His detractors in the board have been removed, but the drama is not quite over. The story has shifted to something called Q-Star. It's a project that OpenAI was working on, Q-Star. Some latest reports have hinted at this. They speak about a leap, a breakthrough of sorts. But this breakthrough was said to be alarming, and concerns were raised internally. Some people working on Q-Star reached out to the company's board. They spoke about the dangers of artificial intelligence and what they were making. They thought it was dangerous. And soon after that, Sam Altman was fired. So was this a coincidence or the final straw? And what really is this Q-Star project? Is it dangerous? Is it something that the world should know about? Here's what we've been able to gather. Reports say Q-Star could be a breakthrough. It may lead to the development of artificial general intelligence, AGI, artificial general intelligence. So how is AGI different from AI? It's about what these models can do. Let's first look at normal AI. AI chatbots like ChatGPT, they work on language, they'll type something out for you, they'll translate a text, and they do this by using statistical predictions. In simpler terms, these are educated guesses. AI chatbots make these guesses after going through billions of pieces of text. They generate what they think is the right answer. But because they're constantly getting trained, that answer can also change, which is why these chatbots can give different responses to the same prompt. You must have seen this. It's all basically very good guesswork. And that's AI for you, artificial intelligence. But that won't be the case with AGI, artificial general intelligence, because AGI focuses on facts and not guesswork. Even initial AGI projects like Q-Star, they work on mathematical problems, things that can have only one answer. Now, AGI is still work in progress if and when it is perfected. We may have something close to real intelligence. And reports say this is already happening. The Q-Star project is allegedly solving basic math problems, junior school level sums. And that's just the first step. These programs will only become smarter with time, and if unchecked, more dangerous with time. Apparently, Sam Altman was pushing this project. It may have something to do with his ouster. Reports say it was adding to existing grievances, but we cannot confirm any of this. Right now, these are just whispers from unnamed sources. What we know for sure is this: the OpenAI board thought that Sam Altman was not always honest. When they sacked him, they released a statement. We told you about it when he was sacked, that this is what the statement said. Let me read it out for you. Mr. Altman's departure follows a deliberative review process by the board, which concluded that he was not consistently candid in his communications with the board, hindering its ability to exercise its responsibilities. This is what the board statement said. It's a vague justification, no specifics. The board said he was not consistently candid in his communications, meaning he may have been hiding things. Were they talking about the dangers of Q-Star? We don't know. The board also said that Sam Altman was hindering their work. But what exactly are the responsibilities of this board? Here's what the company says. The goal is, and I'm quoting, building safe and beneficial artificial general intelligence for the benefit of humanity. Not profits, not innovation, safety and benefiting humanity. OpenAI claims to be a different type of company, which is why the board had someone like Helen Toner as a member, the one who became the arch nemesis of Sam Altman. She's now being removed as he returns. Toner is the director of strategy at Georgetown's Center for Security and Emerging Technology. This is an institute that analyzes the security implications of emerging technologies. Their director of strategy was on the OpenAI board, and she was reportedly a thorn in Sam Altman's side. She was among the members who wanted him gone. But as things stand, she's the one who's out. The entire saga seems murky. Hopefully, we'll get some clarification soon. People make policy. It's the most basic truth of geopolitics. And people have opinions, sometimes good, sometimes bad. But what happens when bad opinions filter into policy? Now, don't be confused. This winding introduction has a point. A former US diplomat has been arrested in New York. His name is Stuart Seldowitz. He used to work in the US State Department. Pretty high ranking too. He used to advise former President Barack Obama. So why was he arrested? This video should make it clear.
You have
an American citizen?
Yeah, they have it.
How did you become an American citizen?
It's not your business. Go.
No, you're right.
I born here.
But you're a terrorist. You support terrorism.
Listen, go. I'm not supporting something.
You do. You support terrorism.
See,
you know why? If we killed 4,000 Palestinian kids, you know what? It wasn't enough.
Go.
How can a person have so much hate inside them? He says killing 4,000 Palestinian children is not enough. He calls a Muslim vendor a terrorist. And remember who he is, a former diplomat of the United States. We dug into his career. This man held some very important offices, like director of the National Security Council South Asia Wing and deputy director of the State Department's Israel and Palestine office. I'll repeat that. This man worked at the Israel and Palestinian Affairs office, a hardcore Islamophobe. It's like putting a pedophile in charge of the nursery. Reports say he served under 5 different American presidents. Most of his top jobs were under Barack Obama. And I must say, great vetting. This is exactly the kind of people you want making policy, hateful and Islamophobic. Before his arrest, Stuart Seldowitz was confronted by the media, the local media. And guess what he said? I'm going to quote it for you. The comments I made calling him out for his support of terrorism, those I think were appropriate. Forget remorse. He's doubling down on what he said. And don't think this was a one-off instance. It wasn't a case of him having a bad day, because there is another video doing the rounds. Once again, it's Stuart Seldowitz and the vendor. Take a look.
Did you rape your daughter like Muhammad did?
Hmm?
Did you rape your daughter like Muhammad?
I don't speak English.
You only speak English?
No English, no.
You don't speak English?
Yes.
All right. Well, that just shows how ignorant you are. Because your Muhammad was a rapist. It says in the Hadith.
Who Muhammad?
In your holy book.
Who Muhammad?
What?
Who Muhammad?
Muhammad, your prophet. You know who he is.
My prophet?
Yeah.
What does Washington have to say about this? I can imagine what Joe Biden will say. This is not the real America. This is an aberration. Except it's not. The war in Gaza has exposed America's hateful streak. I have some numbers for you. Since October 7th, Islamophobic incidents have risen 216%. Anti-Semitic incidents have risen by 400%. It's like Americans were waiting for a trigger, an incident to unleash hate. These are not just random users on social media or faceless trolls on the internet. They can also be former top-ranking diplomats, people who make the foreign policy of the United States of America. Just think about the hypocrisy. Stuart Seldowitz worked at the State Department. He spent 5 decades there. The same State Department judges every country in the world. It releases annual reports on human rights, on religious rights, on freedoms and discrimination. But look at their own officers. They can't buy a hot dog without spewing hate. The New York police have now arrested him. He's been charged with hate crimes. The State Department says it opposes racism in all forms, but I'm afraid it doesn't cut it. There will be larger questions asked. Did this man's personal hate affect America's policy? Remember, the US was then involved in 3 Muslim nations, Iraq, Afghanistan, and Libya. Are we to believe that he was 100% impartial? The man who said killing 4,000 Muslim children is not enough? I highly doubt it. It's also a wake-up call to countries around the world. Don't believe America's claims of moral superiority or their so-called reports on human rights. They could be tainted by racism and hate. Such comments do not help anyone, especially those who are trapped in Gaza. They have no relief from the bombings, at least not yet. The temporary truce has been delayed. Reports say the Mossad chief traveled to Qatar. Now, Qatar, we know, is mediating between Hamas and Israel. Today, they announced a new date for the ceasefire. Tomorrow, 7 a.m. local time. But this delay is raising fresh concerns as well. Will this fragile truce in Gaza hold? Our next report explores.
Tanks are still rolling on the streets of Gaza. These are Israeli soldiers. They're carefully monitoring their targets and launching new attacks with some help from their colleagues in the skies. Today, Israel dropped hundreds of bombs like these. One of the targets was Rafah. The airstrike left the home of a teacher in ruins.
We woke up this morning. We just woke up and found that they targeted the house of this UNRWA teacher. Why is Israel targeting him with missiles? Don't you know it's just a teacher and his children? A whole area is completely eradicated with three F-16 missiles. Why are you all silent? You in Algeria, you in Russia, all of you. Why are you all silent?
But these voices were drowned out by the noise of more bombs dropping from the sky. A ceasefire was supposed to kick in today at 10 a.m. local time, but it has been delayed. A meeting in Doha was supposed to break the impasse. David Barnea, the director of Mossad, is Israel's lead negotiator. Yesterday, he arrived in Qatar to tie up some loose ends. Israel and Hamas have been talking through Qatar for days now. Negotiations have been dragging on for weeks. Earlier this week, there were reports of a breakthrough, but it's yet to be implemented on the ground. So what's holding up the ceasefire in Gaza? Some last-minute details are yet to be ironed out, like which hostage the Hamas will release and how. The militant group has promised to free at least 50 hostages. Most of them are Israeli. They were taken during the terror attack on October 7th. Israel is releasing at least 150 Palestinian prisoners and allowing up to 300 trucks into Gaza that will carry humanitarian aid. On paper, this seems like a fair deal. But the locals think this truce is on shaky ground. They want a permanent ceasefire.
We don't want this. We want a truce for a lifetime. We want our lives to be like all the other countries where our children can play normally and to continue our lives without fighting. We just want a life without war. We've had enough of war.
Israeli forces are still active on the ground, and that's driving the apprehensions of Gazans. Amid the talk of truce, Israel is intensifying its operations on the ground. Their focus remains on the Al-Shifa hospital. Today, Israel's military captured this man, Mohammed Abu Salmiya, the director of Al-Shifa. Israel says Salmiya was giving refuge to the Hamas in the hospital. Israeli forces put out a video too. It shows a new tunnel equipped with a bathroom, kitchen and air conditioning. Israel says this tunnel is under the Al-Shifa hospital. The video had a message for all Gazans.
If the agreement will occur, we will cease our fire. We will be in our positions. We will be ready. We will let and free our hostages. We have a moral obligation for our hostages, but when we bring them back, we go on and we defeat Hamas. We'll fight Hamas, we'll take Hamas down.
Qatar says the truce will kick in tomorrow. The fighting will pause in the morning, and the first set of hostages will be released in the afternoon. Gazans are likely facing a night without sleep.
Now let's turn our attention to the Netherlands, where a political storm is brewing. They've just had a general election. It was a snap election, called because the Prime Minister had decided to step down. That's Mark Rutte. He was Prime Minister for 13 years. When he chose to step down, an election was called. The election took place yesterday, and now the results are in. The big winner is this man, Geert Wilders, often called the Dutch Trump. A conservative politician with striking blonde hair. That's definitely some similarity. But of course, there's more to him than parallels with Donald Trump. And that's what we'll talk about tonight. Wilders and his track record. Also, what his victory means for Europe. This man is famous for two things. The first is his anti-immigration and anti-EU stance. Listen to this.
The hope is that people get their country back. That we make sure that the Netherlands is for the Dutch again. That we limit the asylum tsunami and migration. That people will have more money in their wallets again, instead of spending millions to nonsense. That Netherlands will be more secure again.
People expect our agenda of hope, tougher asylum and immigration policy, the people getting more money to pay for their utilities and groceries.
That was Wilders after opinion polls said he had won. He promised an end to asylum seekers, an end to immigration to the Netherlands. That was the thrust of his campaign. Also, he wants to stop sending aid to others. No assistance to developing nations and no aid to Ukraine. It may be easier said than done because the Netherlands is part of the European Union. It has commitments as part of the bloc. But Wilders has a solution. Leave the EU. He's calling it Nexit. The exit of the Netherlands, Nexit. He's promised a referendum on it. So anti-Europe and anti-immigration, that's what he's famous for. The other thing is his anti-Islam rhetoric. In 2008, Wilders released a film criticizing the Quran, and over the years, he has spoken against Islam.
The biggest threats to our survival today and the threats to our freedom are the European Union, mass immigration, and this terrible Islamic ideology of submission and violence.
He also faced a backlash for all of this and threats. He's been under police protection for almost two decades. In 2009, he was denied a visa by the UK. They feared that he would pose a threat to public security. But he continued with his stance. And some in India might remember him over his support for the politician Nupur Sharma. She had caused an uproar over remarks on the Prophet Muhammad. At that time, Wilders had extended support to her, even during this current Dutch election campaign. This is what Wilders said, that there would be, and I'm quoting, no Islamic schools, Qurans and mosques in the Netherlands. Slight problem with that. It goes against the Dutch constitution. It promises, the constitution promises freedom of religion and expression. And Wilders said he will not breach Dutch laws after he won the election.
It will be horrible for many things. It will be horrible for anyone who has a different background than like a white Dutch background.
That was a representative from the party that finished second. The Netherlands has 150 parliamentary seats. 76 is the magic number to form the government, but reaching that number on your own is almost impossible. The Dutch have a system of proportional representation, which basically means that a coalition government is necessary. So while Wilders won the election, he got only 37 seats. He needs allies to become prime minister.
We will collaborate with other parties because that's what we like, and we'll show that we are able to do it. The Dutch citizen deserves it that the Freedom Party is in the next government, and it will happen.
Who would join his alliance? There are plenty of candidates. Remember, Wilders is a career politician. He's been in office for about 25 years. He's made a few friends in that time, like his former party, the VVD, the party of the outgoing prime minister. During the campaign, they had indicated that they might tie up with Wilders. And then there are other possible allies, parties that have hinted at wanting to join his government. So a coalition is quite possible. But it will require Wilders to compromise because no other party wants to leave the European Union. So will he abandon his dream of Nexit? We'll have to wait and see. He'll definitely have to be more diplomatic to keep a coalition together. His victory has made one thing clear, though. The anti-immigration rhetoric has won. This is what the Dutch have chosen. And the EU cannot dismiss it. They should think about what this result means. The Korean Peninsula is on the boil again. On Tuesday night, North Korea launched a spy satellite, its third attempt in 6 months. But this one seems to have been successful, or at least that's what Pyongyang is saying. And of course, South Korea is not happy about it. So it has suspended its military agreement with the North. Seoul's move may have been retaliatory, but Pyongyang too took it a step further. And they went ahead and scrapped the entire deal. They're even deploying more weapons to the border. What do these developments really mean? Is it mere posturing or another conflict in the making? Our next report tells you.
This is Panmunjom, also known as the Truce Village. It's a part of the Korean Demilitarized Zone, the DMZ, the only portion where North and South Korean forces stand face to face. In 2018, it was the setting of historic meetings. On one side was Moon Jae-in, the then president of South Korea. On the other side was Kim Jong-un, the leader of North Korea. The meetings helped chart the Comprehensive Military Agreement. It was signed that year. The goal was simple: reduce tensions in the peninsula and build trust between the two countries. Of course, it was a lofty goal. 5 years later, North Korea has scrapped the deal. It's deploying weapons and soldiers to the border with the South. So how did it come down to this? The answer lies in a rocket launch. On Tuesday, North Korea launched the Maligyong-1, its spy satellite. North Korea tried to launch in May and August, but it was unsuccessful. So this was the third attempt in 6 months. However, this time, Pyongyang claims it was a successful launch. It says the satellite is now in orbit. The launch sent alarm bells ringing on the other side of the border. South Korea was alarmed, so it had to take measures. Seoul suspended the 2018 military agreement. It said it was restoring surveillance activities at the border.
Until mutual trust is restored between North and South Korea, we plan to pursue the partial suspension of the effectiveness of the 9.19 military agreement. This is a necessary measure and the minimum defense action required for our national security. Furthermore, it is a justifiable measure in accordance with our laws.
Of course, it was a tit-for-tat action, but North Korea decided to take it one step further. They scrapped the deal altogether. Pyongyang said it's sending military and new weapons to the border. So with the deal scrapped, what will the border look like? Many say it won't make much of a difference. They say North Korea wasn't abiding by the deal anyway, but the raked up tensions seem to have worried the citizens of South Korea.
The successful launch of the spy satellite means that their technology has improved that much. With the Ukraine and Israel situation also happening, it's quite true that I feel worried that war can also occur if North Korea has their mind set out in a bad way.
If North Korea advanced their military while South Korea and North Korea confronting each other, I believe South Korea has to prepare thoroughly as well by having close relationships with the United States and Japan.
So, the Korean Peninsula is on the boil once again. Military tensions, new weapons, and distrust between two neighbors. It's the perfect recipe for a military disaster. But will this just be some political tit-for-tat? Or will this lead to actual military confrontation? Well, no one knows the answer for now. But the world definitely doesn't have the appetite for another armed conflict.
Back to Europe. Do you know which is the continent's largest border? It's this one between Russia and Finland. This border is 1,340 kilometers long. There are multiple border crossings, but now Finland has closed all crossings except one. Why is that? Because of a migrant crisis. Helsinki thinks that Russia is trying to weaponize this border. They're accusing Moscow of sending migrants across. The issue started late September. Since then, Finland clocked over 600 migrants at their border. These migrants were undocumented. They were seeking asylum. And they were all coming from countries in West Asia and Africa, the likes of Yemen, Somalia, Syria, and Iraq. Finland says they arrived here with the help of Russia.
Well, we are very concerned about the border situation where Russia is effectively instrumentalizing people, not only letting people through to the Finnish border with invalid documents or missing documents, which has not been the case before, but also we have evidence that Russia is effectively bringing those people to the border and organizing transport as well.
So what is this evidence that they're talking about? Traditionally, Russia does not allow anyone to reach the Finnish border without documents, just like any border crossing in the world. But Finland says Moscow has changed its policy. It doesn't seem to care about documents anymore. Moreover, Helsinki says Russia is helping them. How? By skirting around the rules. And here's what the rules say. No one can walk on foot between the Finnish and Russian border checkpoints. But these migrants are bypassing the rules. They're arriving on cycles and scooters. Where are they getting these from? Finland says Russia is providing these two-wheelers. They're giving vehicles to migrants, then leaving them at the border crossings and closing the gates on their site. And what does Russia have to say about all of this? It obviously denies the allegations. Moscow also says they regret Finland's actions, calling it a highly anti-Russian stance.
We do not accept such accusations. Border crossings are used by those who have a legal right to do so. And in this regard, our border guards fully comply with all their official instructions. And if they try to find some far-fetched reasons, then again, we do not accept such accusations against us here.
Now, this could be just another border crisis, except Finland joined the NATO this year. So now their border is a NATO border, and Helsinki thinks that this is Russia's way of revenge. They're calling it hybrid warfare. It's not the first time that something like this has happened, though. In 2021, there was a similar situation at the Polish border. A sudden uptick in undocumented migrants, most of them were from West Asia, and Poland accused Belarus of manufacturing that crisis. China.
On the border with Russia, Finland is experiencing a similar phenomenon to what we've been dealing with here since 2021. In other words, to sum it up, it's a hybrid attack on the Finnish border, which is carried out by bringing groups of migrants to that border. It's a very unpleasant and challenging situation.
So is Russia doing the same with Finland? Well, Helsinki certainly thinks so. So they're taking steps to prevent any crossings. Finnish border guards are erecting new barriers, including concrete obstacles with barbed wire. They want to keep the migrants out. The EU too has deployed 50 guards to this border. That should certainly take care of it. 50 guards on a 1,300 kilometer long border. Also on the cards is closing the entire border. Finland has not done it yet, but they could if the situation gets worse. Russia, on the other hand, has summoned the Finnish ambassador. They lodged a complaint over the border closures. So as of now, the situation remains tense, a classic Russia versus NATO situation. And caught in the middle are hundreds of migrants stuck in sub-zero temperatures, camping in tents at the border and facing an uncertain future. Now let's talk about the land of fire and ice, Iceland. A Nordic island country known for its glaciers and volcanoes. In fact, one of their volcanoes could erupt any time soon. It has caused thousands of earthquakes in the past few weeks, so residents have been fleeing the region. But guess who is coming in? Tourists. We're not making this up. It's a bizarre travel trend. Volcano tourism. Now, Iceland is one of the most volcanically active places on Earth, and they're making the most of this trend. Their volcanoes attract hundreds of thousands of tourists. And this hot trend is catching on. Japan, Hawaii, Italy, New Zealand and others are also erupting with volcano tourism. The question is, how safe is it? Is volcano tourism a thrill, the thrill of a lifetime, or just a fatal attraction? Our next report tells you.
Only few things on Earth can be as old as this 8,000-year-old volcano and have a name as unpronounceable as Eyjafjallajökull, and still be thrust into the limelight. We're talking about this volcano. It stands tall in southwest Iceland. Back in 2010, it famously sent a plume of ash about 9 kilometers up into the sky. This wreaked havoc on Europe's airways. About 100,000 flights were cancelled. Ideally, such a dramatic feat would gain some bad press, but that wasn't to be. The volcano became an instant hit. Its name was a tongue twister on every news channel. But most of all, it set Iceland's tourism industry on fire. It's been 13 years since. The Nordic island has seen multiple eruptions. After all, Iceland is one of the most volcanically active places on Earth. An eruption occurs every 3 to 5 years. And these regular eruptions have spawned a new travel trend, volcano tourism. Adventurers from all over the world fly to Iceland just to catch a glimpse of the mesmerizing lava. Many people click pictures and toast marshmallows over the lava. But adrenaline junkies go a step further. They bike, hike, abseil, or board across active volcanoes. It may sound bizarre, but in recent years, Icelandic volcanic eruptions have been attracting thousands of visitors. In 2021, the eruption at Fagra Dasyol attracted over 350,000 tourists. Tourists are provided regular updates about eruption sites. They're also given safety instructions. Travel agents set up specialized volcano tours. It's clear that Iceland has turned its lemons into lemonade by turning natural disasters into a booming industry. But Iceland is hardly the only one doing this. Countries like Japan, America, Italy, New Zealand, and Guatemala have also fired up a volcano tourism industry. After all, who wouldn't want a fiery volcanic Instagram picture or an interesting post-vacation story for a change? But the question is volcano tourism just the thrill of a lifetime or a fatal attraction? Is it safe to visit volcanoes and hop, jump, and step over them? Experts don't think so. They say not all eruptions are tourist-friendly. Safety depends on both accessibility and the type of eruption, and this knowledge is sometimes not vastly available. Some volcanic locations are volatile. Volcanoes have also repeatedly destroyed infrastructure, and eruptions often produce poisonous gases like sulfur dioxide, which can cause lung damage and even death. Between 2010 and 2020, at least 1,143 people died in volcanic explosions. In 2019, a famous volcano in New Zealand, Wakari, erupted, killing 22 tourists and injuring dozens of others. It's unlikely that these morbid figures will stop tourists. Volcano hopping can be the thrill of a lifetime. But don't forget that you are playing with fire here.
And now it's time for Vantage Shots, images that tell the story. New York, building-sized balloons sprung to life ahead of a Thanksgiving parade in the city. In Italy, a huge water spout hit the Amalfi Coast. And looks like the British monarchy is a fan of K-pop. The band played Gangnam Style during the change of guard as King Charles honored Blackpink. Finally, we are taking you back in history. On this day in 1992, the world's first smartphone was launched. It was called the IBM Simon. It introduced users to features like touchscreen, calendar, and on-screen keyboard. Unfortunately, it was not a hit. Only 50,000 units were actually sold. We're wrapping up on that note. Thank you for watching. We'll see you tomorrow.
Got it.